Good morning. In yesterday's class, we spoke about PPM detection, how we could detect the PPM signals, the four-step process. The received PPM signal would be something like this, okay, spread out because of the effect of channel noise. So any signal, a rectangular signal, when it passes through a channel, it will surely spread out like this because of the bandwidth limitation in the channel, and it will also be affected with noise. And from these pulses, we will try to use a slicer and we will fix up a threshold, and if it is above that threshold, then you will generate a pulse. So you will generate a proper rectangular pulse as the slicer output, and using these pulses you will be generating the pulse width modulated signal, where the width of the pulses would have changed, okay. And in the next step, we'll pass this PDN signal through an integrator. This integrator will integrate the output of the PDM, like whatever PDM signal is given, it will integrate it. So the integrator output will look something like this. Okay, the area under this curve, rectangular curves, will be plotted. And in the third step, a sample of the integrator output is taken. So you'll be taking samples at proper intervals. Here I've shown you taking samples at the maximum amplitude of the integrator. Okay, usually we try to do that. Wherever the integrator output maximizes, there you try to take a sample, so that you will get a signal which is varying in amplitude. The pulses, where whenever you take a sample and you generate a pulse, the pulse amplitude will vary according to the integrator output, and this will generate a PAM signal, pulse amplitude modulated signal. And we know how to reconstruct PAM. We'll be using a reconstruction low pass filter, and when we pass this PAM signal through a reconstruction low pass filter in the last step, we'll be able to get the shape of the message, the original message, whatever it was. I didn't have much space here, so I've just drawn. The original message shape will be recovered as the final step from the PAM signal. Okay, this is about PPM demodulation. Then we also said the noise effect in PPM is less compared to PAM and PDM, but there is the effect of noise. It will be similar to that of the SNR, will be similar to that of a FM system. In our continuous wave modulation, we had discussed FM systems. So the SNR here will be similar to that. That's what we discussed, and we compared PPM with the continuous wave modulation system and also with respect to noise. So in bad noise conditions, PPM systems will suffer a loss of signal due to the threshold. If you don't determine the threshold properly, there will be loss of signal. Next, we'll move on to the bandwidth noise trade-off. Okay. Actually, this will be the last topic after the theme example in module 4. Quantization comes under module 5. So what is this bandwidth noise trade-off? As far as the analog pulse modulation schemes are concerned, pulse modulation exhibits best noise performance. In the sense, whenever we use carrier as pulses, the noise performance of pulses is much better than continuous wave or analog signals. So in comparison with continuous wave modulation schemes, this PPM performance is very close to that of the frequency modulation or FM system, because both systems have a figure of merit which is proportional to the square of the transmission bandwidth. So the figure of merit of this system is proportional to the square of the transmission bandwidth, as we had discussed in FM systems. We had shown that this figure of merit is proportional to VT square. Even in PPM, it is the same. It follows this rule. Okay. And both systems will exhibit a threshold effect if the carrier to noise ratio or signal to noise ratio is reduced. You remember when we discussed the figure of merit, we spoke about two conditions. Carrier to noise ratio being what? Much, much greater than, instead of SNR, we considered CNR because both are same with respect to FM. In FM, the carrier power itself will be the signal power, right? So when this is much, much greater than one, you would get a proper performance or figure of merit. But if it is less than one, we saw that the noise effects will be higher and it will start with small click sounds. So we drew the phasor diagram and we showed that if the phasor variation moves less than 180 degree, then the noise will be lesser. But if the phasor can rotate completely about the origin, the noise phasor, then it will result in click noises, positive clicks, negative clicks. And if that noise component is much, much higher as it increases, it will completely create loss of signal, leading to spluttering sound. There is a continuous splutter which you hear from your radio and all that. Okay, in sounds. Anyway, here also it's the same threshold effect. So if at all the signal to noise ratio is more than one, then the performance in the presence of noise will be good. Otherwise, the performance may not be so very good. It will be reduced. Can we do better than this? Yes, but not with analog methods. So with analog methods, anyway, even with analog methods today, we have some very good modulation techniques to improve the performance, which can give us figure of merit higher than FM. Okay. A better noise performance, you have certain modulation schemes like minimum shift keying, Gaussian minimum shift keying. There are many, but still with digital, it is much, much better. How do you improve the performance? So what is required is both amplitude and the time should be represented digitally or discretely. Till now, we used to represent only the time axis in steps or in fixed intervals discretely, whereas the amplitude could be anything. Whatever was the message amplitude, the same thing would be retained in the pulse amplitude. The amplitude of the pulses will be same as the message, and there we don't have some fixed slots. Any amplitude could be used. Wherever you take a sample, whatever is the amplitude, 1.1, 3.5, 5.6, whatever, different values could be had. But if we are going to channelize, or if we are going to split the y-axis also into regular intervals, then we'll change from discrete representation to digital representation. So when we create a signal which is discrete only in time, it is called a sampled signal. And this job is done by a sampling circuit. Now, if I have to discretize the amplitude also of the signal, it is done using quantization. Okay. So, what is this quantization? Quantization is a process wherein the amplitude axis or the y axis will also be split into smaller intervals, fixed intervals. Just like how the time axis is split into the time TS, sampling time TS, 2TS, 3TS. Likewise, the Y axis or the amplitude axis will also have fixed intervals. Only amplitudes can be measured in those steps and nothing more than that. So if you get a value in between, then you have to equalize it to the nearest step in amplitude. So when we discretize in amplitude, that is done by a process known as quantization. So sampling is the first step when you are going to discretize an analog signal with respect to time. Quantization is the next step when you are going to discretize analog signal with respect to amplitude. So before going to quantization, which is our next module, fifth module, to finish off with this module, let us just take a theme example, that is how PPM is used in a concept known as impulse radio. This impulse radio is in wide use today. It is existing and it is already being used. Let's just understand what is this impulse radio. Very simple terms, it can be asked for 4 to 5 marks. Okay, how you use PPM in impulse radio. Please remember, the older digital transmission systems or our traditional systems, they would always attempt to minimize the bandwidth of the transmitted signal. We know that digital signals occupy higher bandwidth than analog. Okay, so they always try to minimize the bandwidth occupancy of the digital signals. So when we have to minimize it, filtering becomes a requirement. So how do I minimize the bandwidth? I will do pre-filtering for anti-aliasing effect. I'll band limit the message. Then I'll do post-filtering after detection also. So I'll always try to be applying filters, channel filters, pre-filters, post-filters, so many filters will be used. So filtering is applied to the rectangular pulses to reduce the occupied bandwidth. We don't want the pulses to spread, we will filter it. But there is a method which doesn't follow this philosophy, and this has been called as impulse radio. What is happening in this technique? The information will be transmitted using very narrow pulses which are widely separated in time. So we are going to send the information or the message by means of very narrow pulses which are widely separated in time.
Tracking reactor.
Wi-Fi
connection. Mute yourself. Who is that?
Reactor little.
Kamya.
Huh?
Kamya.
Shoot.
All of you, please take care to mute yourselves. So what is happening in this impulse radio? This is a technique wherein the information or message is sent using very narrow pulses. They almost look like impulses. That's why it's called impulse radio. Okay? So very, very narrow pulses, but they are separated in time using the PPM technique. We know pulse position modulation is a technique wherein we take narrow constant amplitude pulses and separate them in the position or time based on the amplitude of the information or message signal. So if the information signal has high amplitude, the pulses will be separated with a longer time gap, and if they have less amplitude or shorter, they are close by. Anyway, so this PPM technique is used and impulses are used to transmit the signal, and this has been found to be quite useful in we call it as ultra wide band radio. Okay, we call this technique to be used in UWB or ultra wide band radio transmission technique. The other name for this is impulse radio. Okay, because why it's wide band? Can somebody tell me why wide band? Why will this become ultra wide band? Simple logic. I told you before, if you limit a signal in the time domain, what will happen to its frequency spectrum? See, you are trying to use impulses or limited time pulses which are separated in time, in position. Whenever you limit a signal in time domain, the width of this pulse is very, very limited. Okay. So whenever you limit a signal in time domain, So this is with respect to time. With respect to frequency, it will extend up to infinity. Each of these pulses will go. It will result in a sync signal, which will go on up to infinity. Please remember that T and F are inversely proportional. Any signal which is limited in the time domain or which is time limited will go on up to infinite frequency. The signal, its corresponding Fourier transform will extend from minus infinity to plus infinity. And the vice versa is also true. If you limit a signal in frequency domain, then in time domain, the signal will extend from minus T to or minus infinity to plus infinity. Okay, so please remember this logic. That's why, what are we trying to do here? We are trying to transmit the pulses using impulses, right? What are impulses? Impulses are pulses of very short duration. So impulses are pulses of very short duration, which means they are time limited. If they are limited in time, their spectrum or frequency will extend up to infinity. That's why you need a larger bandwidth. And the technique is known as ultra wideband transmission, UWB. Ultra wideband radio transmission or UWB. Okay. And one common type of pulse which is used for impulse radio is called as the Gaussian monocycle. Okay, how does that Gaussian monocycle look? I'll show you. This is the way it looks. It has one negative pulse and one positive pulse combined together. This is how a Gaussian monocycle looks, and we have limited the amplitude between plus 1 to minus 1. Okay, and the time duration for which it exists is tau. And the representation of this pulse as an equation in time domain is like this. The Gaussian monopulse V of t is A, which is the amplitude, t by tau, e to the power of minus 6 pi t by tau whole square. So it's an exponential signal and scaled with some amplitude and time function. Hence you get this kind of wave shape. This signal is known as a Gaussian monopulse, and the shorter you're going to make the time duration tau, it almost looks like an impulse. You have an impulse which varies on both positive and negative side here. Okay, so A is the amplitude scaling factor, tau is the time constant of the pulse, and when this signal is normalized to unit amplitude, it is as shown in the figure. It consists of negative and positive lobes, as we have known. The pulse width tau is typically from 0.2 to 1.5 nanoseconds. Just look at the number. So that pulse width tau will range from how much? 0.2 to just 1.5 nanoseconds. It's very, very small in width. Though we are seeing a pulse which looks quite bigger here, just for us to see how it looks, the shape, we have written it like this. But actually, it is a very small pulse. Is that clear? And how are we going to, the frequency spectrum of this pulse looks like this. You see, we have plotted the normalized frequency on the x-axis, and the spectrum of that signal, V of f whole square, okay, the power spectrum on the y-axis. So that Gaussian monopulse will have a frequency spectrum like this. And as you can see, you see the bandwidth is quite high. It is not, it won't be very narrow. So it will be wideband in nature. Okay. And what are the problems of having wideband signal? If it occupies more bandwidth, naturally you need to supply a huge bandwidth, and the amount of power will be what? The amount of power to transmit the signal will depend on the tau, the pulse width. If the pulse width is small, we try to have lesser power in sending the signal. So the power will decrease, the bandwidth will increase. Okay, and if we try to use narrow band channels to transmit such signals, then that adds some amount of noise. Anyway, so ultra wide band radio has been allowed in many jurisdictions, and there are strict limits on the power which can be transmitted. We don't need to transmit very high power, so it is fine. Okay, so because of these limitations on the transmitted power, this UWB radio works for short range applications, which is less than few hundred meters. Okay, it can work up to half a kilometer or something like that, not more than that. See, this is how the transmission happens. We are using PPM, as I told you. What happens here with PPM? You'll see that how are we going to transmit the pulses. You observe carefully here. When I have this Gaussian monopulse exactly at zero, you see it is exactly at position zero, then it is a reference pulse. It indicates a reference pulse to transmit the next signal. And suppose I shift it before zero, I'll give it a advance, I'll advance it at time, or I'm sending it before zero, then it will represent the bit zero. Okay, how we are using it to transmit the binary data? When it is positioned exactly at zero, it acts like reference. When there is a time advance, a shift to the left, time advance means a shift to the left, then it represents the binary value zero. And if there is a time delay, a shift to the right, you see in this case, this is your zero point and the monopulse has been shifted to the right, then it represents the binary one. So the binary value one will be represented when we give a small delay to the pulse, and a binary value zero will be represented when we advance the pulse slightly. Okay, so here also you can see the next bit is a one because it is after zero, and this is a zero because it is before the reference. So the reference has been taken in the time axis. The amplitude of the Gaussian monopulse is limited between minus one and plus one, as you can see. So it clearly looks like an impulse because the total width of the pulse, the total width of the pulse is less than 1.5 nanoseconds or so. It's quite small. So you can imagine it would be a sudden variation and it will appear like an impulse signal. Is this clear? In module 4, please remember, we have spoken about conversion from analog to digital. The first step in conversion is sampling. And when we do sampling, we are going to discretize an analog signal only in the time domain. And when we sample a signal, we can do it. What? First is ideal sampling, which we discussed, where we used an impulse train to extract samples of the analog signal at particular intervals of time. So the first thing which we discussed was impulse sampling, where we used impulses. Then we shifted to, we analyzed this signal when we used impulses. Yeah, this is the initial model where impulse train was used to sample. And we analyzed that signal in time domain and frequency domain. That is also called ideal sampling. And later on we said this will cause a aliasing effect, or there will be an effect. We also spoke about reconstruction of it. When we got to know that if the signal is not correctly band limited in the time domain, it will spread over in the frequency domain. If you don't limit it, it will go on spreading in the frequency domain, and there will be mix up of signals known as aliasing effect. I'm just talking about the important topics. So with aliasing, we'll not be able to reconstruct the signal correctly. Therefore, you have to make use of anti-aliasing low-pass filter on the input side. And other than that, the sampling theorem, which states that you could, we define sampling theorem correctly, which states that you could sample a signal or you could split an analog signal into discrete pulses or impulses in the time domain and transmit those signals. And finally, you can also recover the signals in the receiver if you sample at a rate which is greater than or equal to twice the maximum frequency component of the message, 2W or 2FM. Only then proper reconstruction could be done. Okay? That is called the Nyquist rate. The sampling rate when FS is equal to 2W, we call it as the Nyquist rate. Then we spoke about ideal sampling is not possible because impulses don't actually exist in nature. So we spoke about natural sampling or pulse amplitude modulation. You see, in the natural sampling, the heads of the pulses would vary according to the shape of the message. And we also spoke about the mathematical analysis of PAM signal. And then we said, if the pulse stops would vary according to the message, then converting that pulse to a proper digital code or a digital value, a binary value, would become difficult because one end of the pulse would be at one amplitude level, and after certain time which is taken for conversion, the pulse amplitude would have changed to something else. So conversion would become a big headache. Conversion from the pulse amplitude value. So flat top sampling is better off when we try to convert from analog to digital, because the amplitude of the pulses will remain constant for a given time. The time it takes to convert from an analog value to a digital value, it needs some constant time, that is fine. So with flat top sampling also, we discussed the mathematical analysis. PAM can be either with natural sampling or flat top sampling. So we did the analysis recovery procedure. We said we have some noise perturbances and amplitude changes for which we have to use an equalizer after the reconstruction filter to get back the correct message. Then we spoke about TDM, which is a process of sending multiple signals on a common channel, but they are separated in time. So for a time duration T1, signal from one message will go. For T2, the signal from message M2 will go. Likewise, you can transmit n different messages at different time slots using a common channel. And after taking samples of the n messages, you can repeat. Anyway, with TDM, we communicate much more effectively. Then we spoke about other forms of pulse modulation, that is PDM, pulse duration or pulse width modulation, and also PPM, pulse position modulation. And we analyzed the equation. We said PPM is more important. The pulse position modulation is more useful because of its fixed duration pulses of short time width or short pulse width and amplitude, minimum amplitude. And in order to generate PPM, we had to go through this procedure. So we will be generating using sawtooth and all that we saw. Detection of PPM also we saw. How we will generate, we discussed today noise effects. And finally, the bandwidth noise trade-off and the impulse radio which could be used. That completes module 4. Now let's move on to the problems in module 4. Yesterday we did some two problems, I think, on finding the Nyquist rate and Nyquist interval. Are you able to see this problem screen?
Yes,
Yes or no? Tell me whether you are able to see this one note.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So I think we discussed these problems on how to find the frequency and the time interval, the sampling time interval. We did two problems based on that. Let's try to do the next problem. Just I told you to try out this. Did any of you try out this problem? Anybody? Yesterday I told you to write this down and try out. A signal g of t given as 2 cos 400 pi t plus 6 cos 640 pi t is ideally sampled at sampling frequency 500 hertz. If the sampled signal is passed through an ideal low pass filter with cutoff frequency of 400 hertz, what are the frequency components that will appear at the output of the filter? So you should find in this signal is made up of two frequency components. I have two cosines which are added in the given signal g of t. So you have to find what will be the frequency components in these signals and then what happens after sampling. You know, when you sample, what will happen to the spectrum? So you have to write the spectrum before sampling, after sampling, and then check out which frequency components will appear in the output of the filter. So what is given here? Given g of t is 2 cos 400 pi t plus 6 cos 640 pi t, right? Now let's try to find the frequency components by taking Fourier transform on both sides. Take Fourier transform on both sides. What would you get? G of f is 2 and I'll get a half inside, so I can write that 2 by 2. For any cosine, it is delta f minus. What is the frequency of this signal? If you write this as 2 pi f1t, what is the value of f1?
200.
F minus 200 plus delta f plus 200. See, you should be able to split this easily. Any signal cos 2 pi ft. 2 pi ft is 400 pi t. So what is f? F is 200. Similarly, in this, if I write this as 2 pi f2 into t, what will I get? What's the amplitude here? 6. 6 by 2. Again, wherever it is a cosine, it is delta f minus f2. How much is f2?
320.
F minus 320 plus delta f plus 320. Okay. So first I'm trying to find what are the frequency components f1 and f2 of the given original signal. So there are two frequency components or two tones in the original signal. One tone is at frequency 200 hertz. The second one is at frequency 320 hertz. Okay. Now, let's try to take the Fourier, or if you want, you can just draw it once so that it's clear for you how it looks. If this is 0, I have one signal at 200 and the amplitude of this signal is 2 by 2, which is 1, and the other signal left shifted at minus 200 with the same amplitude 1. Okay. And what about this? At 320, at a frequency 320 hertz, this is your frequency axis, you have another impulse. The magnitude of this impulse is 3. 6 by 2 is 3. I'm not drawing to scale, so you don't notice the difference between 1 and 3. Anyway, I have another at minus 320, which will also have the magnitude of 3. Okay, so this is your actual input signal G of F. Now, with this, let's try to take, we know that when G of T, we know that when G of T is ideally sampled, then we get what? Sampled signal, we get, it is impulse sampling, we get sampled signal G delta of T with, let me directly take the Fourier transform of that, with Fourier transform G delta of F. Do you remember what is the Fourier transform of the ideally sampled signal? We wrote G delta of F as Fs n tending from minus infinity to plus infinity, G of F minus n Fs. If you remember, we had got this expression for the frequency domain representation of the ideally sampled signal. Okay, so just recall this expression. G delta of F will look like this. Now in this, if I try to substitute the Fs value, you see here the Fs value was given as 500 hertz. Okay. So I'll write Fs outside. Inside I'll substitute. N is minus infinity to plus infinity. G of F minus N into 500. Fs is 500, so it will be 500 n, or n into 500. Now G delta of F can now be written, if I incorporate this signal, see if this is G of F and if this is the representation for G delta of F, you call this 2 and this as 3, you have to use equation 2 in equation 3, what will you get? When you substitute the G of F value here, what will happen to your G delta of F? Fs summation n ranging from minus infinity to plus infinity, and delta, here what was G of F? It was F minus 200 first. So I consider F minus 500 n, which I have as usual, minus 200 will be added because I'm substituting this G of F value, delta F minus 200. I just have to add the delay, that minus 200 should be added to this, right? The other things will be retained as it is. Similarly, let me put a bracket, delta F minus 500 n plus 200. Okay, so I have substituted the first part of this spectrum. That's the reason why we wrote the spectrum. We have G of F as 1 into delta F minus 200 plus delta F plus 200. So when I have substituted that in this, I'm getting delta F minus 500 n minus 200. And delta F minus 500 n plus 200. Okay, so that's the first part. And the second part will be, what is the amplitude here? It is 3 times. So I'll have 3 times Fs. Here it was 1 into Fs. Here it will be 3 times Fs. I have Fs outside the summation. Summation n is equal to minus infinity to plus infinity. Delta, you should always start with this, F minus 500 n minus, what was the frequency of the second signal? 320. So minus 320. Please remember, this is how you add. plus delta f minus 500 n plus 320 hertz. Okay, so you have to get the combined signal like this. I hope you understood till this point. So first we have written g of f, and then we have written g delta of f, the ideally sampled signal. Now in this equation, all you have to do is you have to substitute for n values. Let me call this equation 4. Substituting for n as 0, plus or minus 1, plus or minus 2. Let's see if we want the minus 2, because I think it will result in high frequency. We'll see one case. So first, if you put n as 0, what will you get? For n is equal to 0, what will you get g delta of f as? Fs into delta f minus this term 500 n will become 0. So you have f minus 200 plus delta f plus 200, correct? Plus 3fs, the second term, into delta f minus 320 plus delta f plus 320. So you are getting back the original signal which we had considered. You are getting back g of f when you put n as 0. Next, you try putting n as 1. What will you get? When n is equal to 1, what will happen to g delta of f? Fs into delta f minus 500 minus 200 plus delta f minus 500 plus 200 plus 3fs into delta f minus 500 minus 320 plus delta f minus 500 plus 320, right? So when I put n as 1, I'm getting this value. If you just simplify this, what would this be? Fs into delta f minus 700. The new frequency value becomes f minus 700 and delta f minus 300. I want to find all the frequency components. That is the aim here. Okay, please understand that. And the second term, 3fs into delta f minus 820, both are negative, plus delta f minus, how much, 180, yeah? Minus 500 plus 320, is it 180? Yes or no? Similarly, you substitute n as minus 1. Check out what you will get if you put. Please tell me if I'm making any mistake. In the sense, in the calculation, computations. Fs delta f, this becomes minus 500 into minus 1. N is minus 1. So it becomes f plus 500 minus 320 and delta f plus 500, sorry, minus how much? 200, right? Plus 500 minus 200, the first component. F plus 500, will it be plus 500 n? What would it be? F minus minus 1 into 500 means it will become F plus 500 plus 200, the second component. When I'm substituting n as minus 1, the second component is 3fs. Remember, this whole thing represents the signal. Plus 3fs into delta F plus 500 minus 320 plus delta F plus 500 what? Plus 320. Is that right? Can you compute and tell me how much would the values remain as? Fs delta F plus 300, this will be left shifted. What about this? This is also left shifted. Left shifted means it is of no interest to us. It will go to the left of zero. Check out if you are going to get any right shifted version here. I doubt. Delta F plus 180 plus delta F plus 820. Yeah? Is that right? So all these will represent left shifted impulses. We need not bother about it. So not concerned. We are not concerned about this. Why? Because if you notice here, he has mentioned an ideal low pass filter with cutoff frequency 400 Hz. That means you will have a low pass filter like this. And that filter, it's an ideal filter. That's why we are writing the rectangular shape. So its frequency includes all values between 0 to 400. And any frequency which is to the left of 0 will not be filtered out. They are negative frequencies. They are not our concern now. We should work out to see what are the various components which will come within 0 to 400. And we can do one more thing. Just check for n is equal to plus 2. I think minus 2 we needn't do as we saw. Just put n is equal to plus 2 and see what you will get g delta of f. Do it fast. I think it's time all of you can drop in your USNs also. 5 minutes I'll extend. So fs delta f minus 500 into 2. Minus 500 into 2 means it will be minus 1000. Minus 200, right? F minus 1000 minus 200 plus delta F what? Minus 1000 plus 200 plus 3FS delta F minus 1000. Minus 320 plus delta F minus 1000 plus 320. Just check out what would this give you. Only we are doing this to check if there is any component less than 400 Hz. If you get a component less than 400 Hz, you need to consider it in the filter. So delta, this will also teach you how to analyze the frequencies. What will you get? Minus 1200 plus delta F plus 800. No, plus 3FS delta F minus 1320 plus delta. How much will this be? 1320. 680. Yeah? Minus 1000 plus 320. Is it 680? Okay. Are you people switched off or what? Mind is switched off. See, we are not doing anything extra. We are just writing after expanding these equations. You just need to understand how you would expand the frequencies, the impulses by adding two impulse responses. So here we'll consider, let's try to, I'll call this, okay, equation A, this as B, for n is equal to minus 1, I need not consider, and n is equal to 2, even here I need not worry, look at the frequency components, nothing lies within 400. If you observe all these frequency components, it is 1200, 800, nothing is within 400. So can you tell me what will be the frequency components which lie between 0 to 400? We don't have anything from this last part with n is equal to 2. We don't have anything from n is equal to minus 1 also. From n is equal to 1 and 0, I think we will get some components. With n is equal to 0, what do I have? I should consider only the right shifted impulses. Delta f minus 200 means it is well within the range. So at 200 hertz, I am going to have an impulse of amplitude 1. The amplitude of that impulse is fs. 1 into fs. Fs is 500. So I'll just write it as fs. Next, this is left shifted. You need not bother about that. So the left shifted impulse we'll not consider, only this. Here, the right shifted impulse at 320 hertz is surely less than 400. So at 320 hertz, I'm going to have an impulse with amplitude 3fs, okay? That you should consider. And the left shifted f plus something you need not consider. We are done with n is equal to 0. Now you see n is equal to 1. These are the frequency components. 700 is out of range. We are working at 400, less than 400. So I need not consider even 700, even though it is right shifted. But this I need to consider. At 300, I am going to have an impulse of amplitude fs. So at 300 here, I should have an impulse of amplitude fs, which will be filtered. And anything else? Yeah, this 3fs, 820 will not be considered, out of range. And 180 should be considered because it's less than 400. So at 180 hertz here, just before 200, at 180 hertz, you have an impulse of magnitude 3 times fs. You see here, this is 3fs into delta f minus 180. Okay, that's it. So we are done with both n is equal to 0 and n is equal to 1. And we got 4 components of impulses, 4 different frequencies, signals coming into picture. Remember, each impulse here represents a cosine. So I'll have a signal. If I consider the filtered signal, it will be cos 2 pi into 180 into t plus cos 2 pi into 200 into t plus cos 2 pi into 320 into t, sorry, 300 I have one, 300 into t plus cos 2 pi into 320 into t. All these 4 components will be filtered out by the given filter. If you want, you can write this cosine, or you can just say the frequencies 180, 200, 300 and 320 hertz will be filtered at the output of the filter. That's what is asked. What frequency components will appear in the filter output?